Now that Curtiss-Wright had military funding, their airplane was bound to certain requirements. The fuselage was lengthened to provide better passenger access. Cockpit ejection seats and a rescue hoist were added. The Air Force also insisted on a new designation. The airplane was now called the X-19. Controlling the X-19 in the hover was a difficult task. Before the airplane rose, the trailing surfaces on all four wings were drooped. This was to minimize the wing load caused by the propeller blast. When the X-19 pressed skyward, pitch and yaw movement was controlled by a differential pitch of the propellers. For example, if the pilot wanted the airplane to roll, he simply increased the pitch of the propellers on either the starboard or port side of the plane, depending on which way he wanted to roll. If he wanted the plane to either pitch up or down, he simply increased the pitch of the front or rear propellers. Yaw was simply controlled by adjusting the tilt angle of the propellers in the appropriate direction. When any VTOL airplane comes into land, the engine blast hits the ground and recirculates in all directions. Much of this air bounces back to the plane. Hovering in still air was difficult enough. Hovering in a violent windstorm made every landing an adventure. The X-19 program was plagued with problems. It flew in November of 1963, but was quickly grounded for mechanical problems. The pattern of short flight followed by prolonged visits to the workshop would be repeated again and again. After its maiden flight, the X-19 did not fly until June of 1964. 2 months later, the aircraft made its first controlled hover, before again being grounded for stability problems. The airplane did not fly again until January of the following year. During this flight, a propeller failure delayed flight tests for 5 additional months. In over 2 years, the X-19 accumulated less than 4 hours of flying time.